Hello, Western Civ 104. I believe we're in week 11. I was mentioning to my other classes in the announcement that I think I skipped 2 weeks of making an official announcement like this. I was making other announcements. If I happen to be wrong on the being the 11th week, then don't freak out. That's just here in my mess up of my use of words. It doesn't affect anything. Other than maybe a light confusion, but I think it's week 11. Anyhow, so your absent professor moves on. We are entering a really interesting set of topics. We cover a wide range of topics this week, and I think that the Black Death, the plague. It's always exciting to learn about those things. I think about that now, you know, as I'm walking through these kind of like cobblestone streets here in Leiden, and everything seems so perfect and picturesque. And I've been talking with my friend, and her and I were just, we were chatting as we were walking down the street, and I was like, you know, it hasn't always been this nice here. And I mean, meaning that, you know, European nations, sometimes places you go to that look like this, so nice, people were dying like crazy, and there were inquisitions, and, you know, people being tortured for their religious beliefs and all this crazy stuff. In fact, actually, what's wild here in the Netherlands, they were occupied by the Nazis and militarily. And so I went to the windmill. I had a little tour that someone gave me. He owns it. His family's owned the windmill for since the 19th century, and now it's a historic monument. And he was showing me these metal parts, which wouldn't be all that exciting actually to learn about for me. I'm not really mechanically inclined or whatever. But what he was saying is that this was one of the few windmills that have the original iron pieces, because his father and other family members hid all of those away when the Nazis came in and invaded, because they didn't want them to take them and melt them down for the war effort for the Nazis. And that's actually what happened. So though he doesn't really know. I asked him where they hid them and how, you know, did the Nazis try to shake them down and like find out where they were or what kind of issues happened. And he said he doesn't know. He just knows that they were able to put those away somewhere and then get them back after the end of the war. So you're like, wow. Like, and what always reminds me, what I'm always thinking, is that like, even when you're a really nice place, the positive side is that things were really bad once here and now they're really good. And then sometimes I think, man, sometimes you can be in a place that's really good and it can go really bad. So there's several ways to look at it. And that's what I do as a history professor, and I teach history. And what you realize, that wherever you're at, it can always get worse and it can always get better. And sometimes it does a set of cycles of those things, you know, over the centuries. So, you know, voting is just happening, right? That's what made me also think about that. And everybody's getting along perfectly. There's no controversy with anyone. It's like harmony on Facebook and social media. No, right. Everybody's mad at each other. Yeah, we're not United States right now, that's for sure. I mean, we are the United States, but we're not a united United States. And it's it gets a little ugly out there. So I just want to say this. I try to keep my classes as neutral as possible, meaning that I don't want my students to ever feel that my politics are being shoved down your throat, or that when I'm grading you or we're corresponding, that your viewpoint of something on a political or ideological, theological, any of those old ology, you know, idea, like any of that should not affect how I grade you or how you feel about how I'm feeling towards you. And I think that you all feel that I'm not like that with you. Now, outside the classroom, I'm very political, I'll be honest. And on my social media, I do have very strong opinions, right? Because we all do. We're human beings. and you're going to be informed in a certain way with certain inclinations, and you're going to make a statement. So having said that, I hope everybody is getting along as well as possible. I am posting underneath this announcement a little documentary clip that you're not required to watch, but I'm encouraging you to watch, on the U.S. role in Latin America. And the reason is because there is this big controversy about the caravan, right? That's been coming up. Now, this documentary clip is very biased. It's put out by Al Jazeera, and it really makes a very hard critique of the United States government, essentially saying, look, they've treated Latin America so bad, that's why the caravan's coming. And, you know, basically America should let the caravan through. That's kind of the impression you get from the video. Now, the reason why I'm showing this to you, because I usually kind of prefer to give you a little more nuance or something not so direct, is because there really isn't an alternative way of teaching this history. I mean, there sort of is, and I'm gonna give you a little different side of that. For the most part, what I have realized over the years, because I do actually teach this section in my World Civ 107 class, by the way, and a little bit in like US 102, which they never gave me 102 to teach, and I think I might cover a little bit in Western Civ, but the U.S. role in Latin America is very intense and it's very extreme, and it's been going on since the Monroe Doctrine, but it more so during the Cold War, and it's pretty rough. I mean, the U.S. has been supporting brutal dictatorships, and actually, right now, there is a man coming to power in Brazil that is quite. I mean. I think he said it was better for his son. It'd be better for his son to be dead than to find out he's gay. And I hate to repeat this one comment, but he said, I think a woman was too ugly to be raped. This is the kind of comment. He just came to power, and Bolton, the U.S. official, just congratulated him on restoring or keeping democracy in Latin America. This, though, is standard. It's not just Trump. It's not just Trump's team, this thing. The U.S. government, from Democrats to Republicans, have been very consistent in their approach to south of the border. And what I will say is this, to give you another perspective. A conservative viewpoint of this would be to say, look, during the Cold War, we had the communists coming in. Look at Cuba went communist, and then Fidel Castro had warheads, nuclear warheads, pointed at the United States from the Soviet Union. I mean, it was a big deal to keep any pushback from the Soviet Union to be in this neighborhood. And so the United States was going to support any type of regime, no matter what it took, to push back Soviet interests. And so it's this kind of Machiavellian view, right? We studied in this class Machiavelli, the ends justify the means. That is the real argument of the U.S. government and officials and historians to justify the policies that have been taking place there. But the reality is they barely even make that argument, because it seems that it's been to the advantage to just not have it be a topic at all. So I'm not really being biased. I'm actually making things fair and balanced. I'm giving you the information that's not even being discussed on any media station about the U.S. role in Latin America, which will put a context into the massive immigration issues that have been taking place. And so what I'm hoping is, if you don't like the bias that comes out of this documentary, that you will be motivated to explore more of what the U.S. Has been doing, and think about the justification aspect, so that at least as these divisive topics come up in American political life, you will have an understanding about, well, what is going on south of the border? What has been going on? Why all the drama? And something that's not talked about in there, it's also something that we should always keep in mind. The U.S. has a very high demand for cocaine. Cocaine is a big thing. It's a big party drug. There's a lot of people doing a lot of cocaine. And where are they getting it from? south of the border, and it's created very powerful mafia cartels. That's not something that the video, I don't think, talks about, and it's also not being talked about. So we have to, it's important, I think, to think about those kind of things, right? So what I'm trying to encourage you is to be a more informed person regarding these sensitive topics, as opposed to just, you know, it's like a lot of people are just deciding, the way the rhetoric sounds is like, you rather don't care about the border and you just let everybody in, or the other person just hates everybody who wants to try to get in and doesn't, you know, has like, you know, and the issue of racism or not and blah, 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 blah. So let's just get to the heart of the matter. And I think the documentary will help move you in that direction. What I will say is this really briefly about this is my experience, and I mentioned this to other classes, and this is anecdotal. I don't have a statistical analysis to give you from any textbook. I think for white Americans, meaning Americans that don't have any ethnic backgrounds or living family connections in Latin America, but this would be true of anybody that has a background from Latin America that's not involved or family, that's not staying connected, that this is shocking information. And many students that learn about U.S. involvement in Latin America, that's when they kind of become like anti-American, radical, anarchist, socialist kids in the college campus. And then we professors get blamed for corrupting the youth and making them anti-American because the great liberal conspiracy, our cultural Marxism is destroying the country because, you know, of what we're teaching these students. Well, I think this is one of those parts. And but I don't have an agenda that grandiose. I just kind of like people to be a little more sane and good to each other and make policy decisions that are productive. But I don't know. Maybe that is a radical. You know, I've had my share of a lot of swimming in different ideological pools. Whatever. In any case, that's my little thought on what's going on there. My little video to show you, okay, take it or leave it, whatever. We have this history about Western Civ. It's very interesting and covers, again, many different topics. So if you want to talk about the history that we're covering, or you want to talk about the current set of events with me, you know, feel free to hit me up. I will just end it here. Have a great week, and we'll be in touch.